I know you've got an ear out for the start of the podcast, but before we jump into today's episode, I wanted to remind you to keep an eye out for Daryl Lee's limited edition Christmas treats, because they're in stores now. Like the iconic Christmas nougat pudding, so yummy and a gorgeous little gift. And some delicious Chrissy-themed twists on your favourite treats, like the Daryl Lee Rockley Road with chewy red and green jelly pieces, green and red crunchy milk chocolate balls, my favourites, and green apple and strawberry flavoured licorice. Watch them disappear. Your Christmas treats table will pop with colour and scrumptiousness. Spread some joy, bring the fun, and enjoy the Christmas tradition that is Daryl Lee. Hurry before they sell out. Daryl Lee makes Christmas better.
You're listening to a DM podcast.
Welcome to The Five of My Life with me, Nigel Marsh. As an author, ad man and theologian, I've always been interested in people's stories. Not just those with a high profile, but people from all walks of life, regardless of fame. Which is why I created this show. Each guest who takes the Five of My Life challenge chooses a favourite film, book, song, place and possession. They tell me their choices in advance so I can research them, but they don't tell me why they've chosen them. That's the subject of our conversation. It's amazing what you can learn when discussing someone's five choices. I hope you enjoy listening to the show as much as I enjoy making it. Stewart MacFarlane is quite simply one of my all-time favourite artists. Born in Adelaide in the 50s, he entered the South Australian School of Art at the tender age of 16. At 21, he travelled to New York to study at the School of Visual Arts. And since then, alongside a music career, he has held over 50 solo exhibitions in major galleries around the world, establishing himself as the master of Australian contemporary narrative painting. So, Stewart, welcome to The Five of My Life.
Well, you've got me all the way to Sydney, Nigel. It's amazing. I haven't been to Sydney for years.
And you've come specially. You bloody angel.
Well, yeah, I'm on my way to Tasmania. So it is a stopover. So right. It worked out very well. So
I've got a bit of a confession. I feel a little bit like a Rolling Stones groupie who's having dinner with Mick Jagger. Because I sodding adore your work.
That's incredible.
Just adore it. So to have you on the show for me massive thrill. And I'm worried I am going to fuck up the interview because I just am in awe. But so I'll try and stick to the format. And what we do is we always start with the film on Five of My Life. And mm-hmm. You have chosen the film adaptation of the musical, which was also an adaptation of the opera, the 1875 opera Carmen. It's the 1955 film, all black cast, Carmen Jones. Tell us your story on Five of My Life about that.
My dad took me to see Carmen Jones when I was maybe 7 or 8, just by myself. And there were 3 kids in the family. And I just remember it was just me and him. And I remember the impact of that film. And it must have been in the early 60s, perhaps, even though the film was released in 54, somehow it was at the movies in Adelaide, and there I was watching it with Dad, and I was blown away. Just the impact was huge on me, and you know, of course, I didn't know anything about, you know, all black or white. Didn't mean anything to me, but it was incredibly powerful, and I was very, very seduced by Dorothy Dandridge. She was just, you know, like as a boy who was like only about 8, maybe I was 10, I don't know, but I was just completely hypnotized by her. And you know, she was kind of good and evil at the same time to the poor leading guy.
That's Harry Belafonte.
Belafonte, yeah. Yeah. And she just completely just got into my brain. And it's so much so that it kind of affected me years later when I moved to New York. My first wife was a local woman who was a black woman in New York, and I just kind of like fell, you know, for some sort of like Dorothy Dandridge lookalike.
Did you confess that the reason, sweetheart, taking you for a date?
Not really. It just kind of like it was just in me, you know, just there was something in me which I just kind of fell, you know. So,
and would you mind telling me a bit more about the first wife, if I'm assuming that she's no longer the wife?
But it was a short marriage. It was, I got married when I was 24, Joanne, and we met at art school. I was studying in the School of Visual Arts on 23rd Street in New York City, and she was just on the same, you know, level as me in the same studio space, and I just kept looking at her all the time, wanting to talk to her, but she was very unapproachable. But I finally started joining the classes that she was in. So she did these weird classes like opera studies and things like that. So I'd sit next to her, and I finally got to talk to her. And it took quite a while. And once we became involved, things happened quite quickly. But it was never right from the start. We were always kind of like a bit sort of edgy with each other. And I was about to break up with her. And then she said, well, if you break up with me, I'll never talk to you again, but if you stay with me, we'll get married in 3 days' time once we can see a judge.
Wow. So she's all on red, all on black, like
that's
I
right.
do at the casino. No point messing around.
No, there was no like, you know, let's try for another 6 months or a year. It was just like, so I just said, like, what the hell, you know. Yeah. I was 24, you know, I got married, and it was a disaster.
So you are malleable. So she played the big card. Yeah. You went okie dokie, and then what? From woke up the next morning going, that was a disaster, or did you have a month of bliss? Or
oh, look, we limped along for 3 years, but you know, like when it got bad, it got really, really bad, because you know, just our world, you know, like the way we dealt with the world, our backgrounds were so different. It was so difficult to meld it together and just, you know, make it cohesive. So our arguments were huge, and I just, you know, got too much. I just had to leave.
And any kids from that marriage?
No, there were no kids. Yeah.
And still in touch, or that's a different life?
We were in touch, like occasionally, about every 10 years. Right. There might be an email or something, but yeah.
Wow. And on Dorothy, I have to say, I mean, I didn't see it until I was 59, in your honour, but I just thought she was electric on the screen.
Yep.
Just absolutely electric. But
yep.
A really sad life.
Yes,
just
yes.
Just a really, really sad life. And it makes me want to ask you, going straight in, heroin. I've read, I'm just going to say all your stuff. I'm sure there's lots of your stuff I haven't read, but I've read lots of your stuff.
Wow.
Would you mind talking a little bit about heroin? You see, I mean, I've only been in Australia for 21 years, but apparently it sort of like wildfire went across Australia.
In the 70s, when I was, you know, just starting to get independent, you know, as a young adult, it seemed to be everywhere in Australia. And I was always aware of it and always scared of it. Probably because of another film as well, The Man with the Golden Arm by Frank Sinatra. So there was a couple of warning films I saw when I was a kid, which scared the hell out of me about alcoholism, heroin, things like that. So I saw a lot of it, and I have been impacted by it. My first girlfriend got addicted to heroin, and she was...
Is that Marianne?
Marianne, yeah. That's right. And I've never known if she lived or died. I left, you know, because I left for America when I was 21. And when I got to America, heroin was everywhere in New York City. You know, like I got into the music scene. Most of the bands were, you know, like addicted to it. They pretended they were heroes, you know, and you know, most of them are dead now. So heroin was just everywhere. It seems to have like turned now into other weird, horrible drugs, you know, ice, fentanyl, whatever it is.
Yeah.
But heroin used to be huge.
And you dodged that bullet.
I was terrified. I hate needles. Absolutely. I was never going to be seen sticking needles into me. But occasionally in New York, it was, you know, so rife that, you know, like there was marijuana everywhere in New York in the 70s. And occasionally you get mixed into joints and things like that. So
there's a wonderful English comedian, Daniel Kitson, and he talks about sort of the upsides of him being a scaredy cat, which absolutely is me, where my cowardice around drugs saved me until I was mature enough to then now just not want them because it's a bloody stupid idea. But when I was a young man, I... terrified, I wouldn't, no thank you, I don't want to stick that needle in my arm.
Yes.
But if I was braver, I bloody well would have. It wasn't moral superiority, it was I'm terrified. Whereas now, not moral superiority, it would be a conscious choice, thank you, I don't need to be doing that.
I don't want to be slumping down in the streets, you know.
Well, listen, I'm glad you resisted that. Yeah. We're moving to the second choice, and I can't wait to hear what your story and rationale behind this choice is. Because I, for what it's worth, I studied theology for 8 years, and you have chosen the first guest so far on Five My Life. Someone has chosen a Bible, a copy that their twin brother gave them, mm-hmm. but no one has chosen the Bible.
Right.
So could you first of all describe, because there are lots of them, mate, there are lots of different versions, describe the Bible in your terms, what you mean by it, and then tell us your story.
Well, you know, there have been sort of various formats of the Bible, but I guess the King James Bible is probably the most reliable. But putting that aside, when people choose other books, it's kind of like you're picking something of a lower level when there's a foundational book which usually influences all the other books. And from the time of like Shakespeare, for example, where he has related to the Bible about 1,300 times in his plays, and that's the first generation. He was from born in 1564, I think, and from that generation, the Bible was pretty much available to everybody. And most people went to church. They were sometimes mandated to go to church, so they all knew theology. So they would actually use these biblical stories and then refer to them and bounce off them because they're so seminal. These stories are just like they're about stories about our families, about how flawed we are. If people ever think we come from you come personally from a dysfunctional family, I mean, you just have to look to the families in the Bible. Starting with Cain and Abel, how two brothers hated each other.
Yeah.
And then just go on from there. And families are just completely messed up. So it's not a book about perfect people. It's about imperfect people with incredible stories. And so, say, Moby Dick refers to the Bible, the story about the whale, basically is referring to something in Job 41, where it is this sort of monster which you're trying to tame with a fish hook. And even the first line in Moby Dick is, "Call me Ishmael," which is Abraham's first son. And then if you look to other really important books, Grapes of Wrath, for example, yep. From Revelation 14:19, the Grapes of Wrath, the title comes from this quote, "The angel swung his sickle on earth and gathered its grapes and threw them into the great winepress of God's wrath." And most of Bob Dylan's work, the greatest songwriter of the modern age, he constantly looks to the Bible for characters, for stories, All Along the Watchtower. If you look at that, it's probably from the book of Revelations. So, all these great writers, why would you look to some sort of minor writer when you have a foundational book which was in everybody's house and respected, and people learnt language from it, and they learnt how to write stories? It's been pushed aside in modern times and sort of like laughed at, but it's just a foundational book.
Wow, amazing that you've got all those source references, chapter and verse as well. So do you read it regularly, and would you mind talking about your own faith and religious journey?
Okay, so the Bible, I probably read through it about 3 times properly from start to finish, but I'm nowhere near sort of understanding it, remembering it. It is so changeable, complex, depending on what you're going through in life, how you're feeling. And sometimes it's just not easy to read, and it's kind of blocked. You get blocked from actually getting into it. It just seems so difficult sometimes. It's always ever new. I just keep coming back to it and then trying to get into it, relearning from it. But for me, I went through 25 years of New Age stuff. I followed all sorts of gurus. I read many other sort of religious texts and things, trying to get some answers for a really long time. And it was in 1996 that I actually sort of like just dropped everything else and just gave up, surrendered basically, when I was in my early 40s, and went back to church again and realized the way for me is through church, through Christ, and through the Bible. And I was just so mixed up for most of my life. I'm still mixed up, but
denomination would be the church that you go to?
I don't buy into denominations,
right.
I because they can all be absolutely flawed, screwed up. Yeah. To me, it's about the teaching. It has to be biblical. I have to have a very good pastor or preacher, and those two things are the first things I look for. If they're not in place, I don't go. So,
do you attend weekly or monthly or?
I go every week. Yeah. If I don't go, I don't. I feel something's incomplete.
Yeah. Wow. So I have been on a journey, as cliche, self-help journey for all my life, and ended up going to the Quakers.
Mm-hmm.
Because I would like to have your faith, but I can't pretend I believe things that I don't believe.
Yeah.
That makes sense. But I wish I did believe them, but I don't. But I'd like to access all the other good stuff.
Yes.
Right? And the Quakers. I mean, and apologies to any Quaker who's listening. Is they are the lowest church you can find in terms of you have to pretend that you believe in less.
Yes,
it makes sense.
Yes.
And the wonderful thing they've got, which is there's a little bit of God in everyone, and I add in an O. So it's a little bit of good in everyone.
Right.
So I go in. So I don't feel like I'm being disrespectful because I'm pretending I believe stuff that I don't if I went to a high, a high church Catholic service or something.
Yes, right? Yes.
But there have been times when I have driven home from a Quaker service, and I imagine it could be any service, where I just feel like a better man, like I'm going to, I'm less self-focused.
Yeah.
And we dragged the kids to a church service at Christmas, which is very unusual for us. But you think, hold on, it's Christmas, for Christ's sake. It shouldn't just be, presents and whatever. And the same thing happened. So it would be great if there was a version that, could unite everybody where you get together and you're not stabbing each other or hating each other. Mm-hmm. You're being eyes to lift your eyes to heaven and be slightly kinder is my, wet version of it.
It sounds good. I mean, that's why, to me, the Bible is the guidebook, you see, and churches are they're the next step, but, they're not everything. So referring back to that, if you have something in life that's a problem or, confusing, then, look at the Bible. And a lot of people, of course, have trouble with the Old Testament because it's so severe, but then the New Testament and Christ's teachings are what, Christians follow. So
the Old Testament, hilarious. The chapters which are, Dave begat Sue, begat, James begat Charles. Yeah. You go, there are some hard chapters
it's
to get through.
It's hard to consume, I agree. I've struggled with that.
Well, mate, thank you. There's been 130 guests now, and I just love the different way people approach the choices and how it gives an insight into the people. Because I think you are a very, very, very special talent and man, and your art is just sensational. It's thought-provoking. It's surprising. It's joyous. It's always fresh. And I wouldn't have known ever what you've just told me. And it's just a delight to find out the man behind the genius works.
I just quickly on that, I just somebody sent me a little quote from Nick Cave recently, and he's always a little surprise. So in a very recent interview, he said, today, if you want to be a rebel, you have to go to church and you have to be conservative. And that's a quote from him in the past couple of weeks.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Do you know the band The Waterboys?
Yes.
Just fantastic. One of their best songs, I think, ever. But, better than The Hole of the Moon, better than, Fisherman, whatever else, is Thou Who Art in the Sky.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you go, well, that's right. And it's even... There are some things that influence people than they don't even know they're being influenced.
Right.
But also there are people like Nick Cave. I wouldn't have realized he'd said that. Well, you go, it's surprising who has got a connection to it.
Yeah.
And it's easy to mock religion, and I don't think people should. And, I think everyone should be able to believe what they believe. But it's nothing shameful. It seems the only people you're allowed to take the piss out of in popular culture these days, comedians or whatever else, is Christians.
Mm-hmm.
We can all have a laugh and take the piss, and you go, well, I just calm your farm a bit and have a little bit more respect, because you don't do that to certain other religions.
Absolutely right. Yeah.
Your third choice on Five of My Life is the first track on the debut album of Denise Williams. She was a backup singer for Stevie Wonder, sung wonderfully on Songs in the Key of Life, one of my favourite albums. Explain to us why you've chosen It's Important to Me, the 1976 track.
I became aware of it in 1977 when I was married to my first wife, and it reminds me very much of New York. And the whole album is called This Is Niecy, Denise Williams, and it was produced by Maurice White from Earth, Wind & Fire, which is, you know, like my most favourite band from the 70s. And they just make superb sounds, superb music, and they backed up Denise Williams on this first album. And I just remember putting it on, and it would just soak over me every song. And it was when I first was in love with my first wife and were living in a loft in Soho in New York and during the summer, and it was just so beautiful. And to this day, when I want a beautiful lift, I put the album back on again. So.
And are you a vinyl man?
Yeah, I've got thousands of vinyl.
Oh, I think we might be coming to talk about that. But so given we're on songs, you're a bit of a rock star yourself, mate. Don't be shy. Squawk. Was it Squawk or Squaw?
Squaw was my first band in Adelaide, yeah.
And Slim Pickings?
Slim Pickings in Adelaide. And Narcissus was another band in Adelaide, yeah.
And didn't you have brushes with David Byrne and Jimmy Barnes, or am I making all this up?
I had those first bands in Adelaide, then I moved to Sydney. I had a little band here for a few months in 75. We actually got on one of the first episodes of Countdown.
Right.
With a recording sort of competition. We came third in that. So we were on TV. That was fantastic. Then I moved to New York City and met a guy at art school who was a really good musician, and we became very good friends, formed a band, recorded an album that got released in France, and played around Manhattan quite a lot. Actually, yeah, bumped shoulders with David Byrne, played on stage with Johnny Thunders. You just met all of that sort of like era of New York of punk and all that.
And you were like 23, living the dream.
I was actually by that point, I was about 26, 27.
Right.
So I actually felt like a bit of an old man at that point, like, you know, being in a rock band was. And I was thinking, I'm getting close to 30. What will happen then? I better make it quick, I was thinking, you know, so.
And were you still painting at the same time?
Yeah, no. See, like, I found it hard. I was doing music so seriously that I just dropped painting for 2 years and just did music. But it was getting, I was getting quite ahead in music. But at the same time, all of that stuff that drives people insane was starting to drive me insane. Things were moving too fast. Things were too accessible. It was too decadent. I was actually starting to feel very, very depressed.
Right. And gosh, and then was there a moment that made you give it away?
Pretty much. In my life, I'm a little bit too sensitive to things. So I was noticing a lot of things that are happening around the same time. So our band had a TV appearance, and somehow there was a strike at the TV studio that night. We had a gig, and the gig was shut down for some reason. There were about three or four things all happening around the same time. And I also, my personal life was a mess. And I just thought, no, I'm just going to take a break. And I came back to Australia for a few weeks, took a break, then the band just folded, and I had a real hard time getting it back together. So.
Right. Okay, well, I think we might be segueing into, I can't wait to hear you talk about this. It's your fourth choice, is your favourite place, and I'm very delighted that you've chosen your studio. Now, in researching you, mm-hmm. I have seen about 9 of your different studios throughout your career. So any particular one, your current one, explain it, describe it, and then tell us the story.
Okay. I say a studio because, you know, if I picked a city, I thought about that. And, you know, someone could say New York or Paris. But to me, the world keeps changing so much that places change. And what used to be good for a certain period of your life doesn't suit later on. Like for me, I used to love New York City, but today I don't like it. It's you know, partly too sanitized. It's all too groupthink. So I just don't like it. I feel uncomfortable there. Whereas when I went there in the 70s, it was so edgy and so
dangerous.
It was incredibly dangerous. But I just threw myself into it, and that made it more exciting. So I wouldn't say any other city either, or, you know, I wouldn't say Sydney or, you know, Paris or anything. So where I feel best, my best favorite place, is when I make a beautiful studio and I always have a beautiful sound system, and there's, you know, nothing makes me happier than putting on some great music and just starting a painting that I'm excited about, and I get drawn back into it and I have to keep finishing it. So that's my happy place. So I've had umpteen studios. I couldn't even count them. The one I'm currently in, took me almost, close to a year to get together. And it's a beautiful studio. And unfortunately, I might not be there for that much longer. And I'll have to create a new studio. So
tell us a little bit about your process, because I have, I've just eaten up everything I can find about you, and there's videos of you playing the guitar, your writing, but also there's quite a lot of you in the studio, and the exhibition that I just adored was one of your drawings. So I accessed you through your paintings. There are certain occasions in my life I don't know anything about art. I just like it. So I remember seeing a Jeffrey Smart exhibition and being just completely overwhelmed, like I've been punched in the face. I remember seeing Bronzino's work for the first time and think, holy crap, how did I not know that? And that's what I thought when I saw your work. This bloke is on fire. It's amazing. It's initially grabs me. It's got intrigue in it. There's always stacks of nudity, which we need to talk about. And then the drawing exhibition was an insight into how you created the paintings themselves. So I mean, a bit like bloody Rolf Harris, or you can't mention him anymore, but you know, those guys that do paintings, you know, in one go.
Yes.
Yeah, I sort of imagine, oh, he just, how, what a genius. He just creates that thing of beauty.
Yes.
And then it's not usually that simple. It took more than an hour of you painting it. So would you mind talking a little bit about how you create your gorgeous pieces of art?
Thanks for that question. My process is kind of like, it took a while to get together. When I first went to art school, I've always been a realist. I've always loved storytelling. One of my first paintings, when I first started painting, when I was about 13, was of a demonstration, a street demonstration, where people were pushing a car over and rioting in a street. So there are stories coming from. It's usually to do with social issues, but I'm not preaching about anything. I'm just observing, sort of, often the decay of society and relationships. And but the way I had to start learning how to do it was, I had various different people guide me through it, various different artists. And one of the earlier ones who influenced me quite a lot was a guy named David Dowitz, an Adelaide artist who I used to watch him draw in life drawing classes at art school. And the way he simply broke down a figure, the way he constructed a painting after that, that was really important to me. Then I moved to New York and I had some very good figure. You could just choose your teachers in New York. You didn't just do a painting class. You had like 10 different teachers to choose, So I chose figurative painters who I liked, whose work I saw in exhibitions in the Manhattan. And got close to them and learned to
Chuck Close and Alex Katz and people.
Yeah, Alex Katz, Chuck Close. My main teacher at art school was a guy named John Button, who's now dead. But then John got me into the studios of Chuck Close and Alex Katz. So I started working in Alex Katz's studio and watching his process. So for a while, I copied that for about 2 or 3 years. My paintings got very simplified. I was trying to, there's no way to really, copy Katz. He's absolutely brilliant. So I had to switch after that and create my own style. And that happened in about 84, where I would draw from the figure that I wanted I'd do a drawing. Then I'd blow that drawing up. Then I get the person back into the studio and continue painting from them 3 or 4 times until I got, enough information.
It's incredible hearing how it works behind the scenes. And there's something that you said in a previous interview. Is there was a stage in your life when you were gridding, that's probably the wrong word, but it's like, in my words, like tracing from photographs, blah, blah, blah. Yep. And you can make wonderful, wonderful art like that.
Yep.
And then you went through an amazing phase where you think, hold on, that's sort of like cheating. Can I do it from life?
That's right.
And mate, the answer is yes, you can. But you had to prove that to yourself.
I did. Even before I went to art school, I was drawing all the time. I have drawings of I did of my family, which were, when I look back on them now, they're quite realistic. They're well done. And that's, I even presented those when I first went to art school when I was 16 and I got a scholarship. So I could do that. It was possible. But to put it all together, it took until I got to New York to actually put it together. So I saw the incredible competition in Manhattan that I had to somehow throw myself in amongst. And so I just kept trying to step myself up, and I'd just paint from life as precisely as possible. So there was a period when I did very realistic paintings, but they were all just done from life. And then I kind of like switched when I got back to Australia to try and find my own style. And so in 84, when I went to the Victorian College of the Arts in Melbourne, I think that's when I first got the style that people recognise now as my style.
And I was trying to describe it to people because I eulogise about you to everybody. If I, and please don't be offended because, gosh, I don't really, I'm not an art expert, but Hopper, is Hopper like
he's probably, he's like, you know, if you talk about the seminal book as a Bible, Hopper will be the seminal artist.
Okay, brilliant. And maybe Smart, I don't know. Hopper, Smart,
Not so much Geoffrey Smart. I really respect Geoffrey Smart and he really inspired me, but I don't look to him like I look to Hopper. There's something about Hopper's way of seeing contemporary society, the edginess of it. When I look at Geoffrey Smart, I see a formula played out, you know, a little bit too obviously. It's always the dark skies, the little figures, and the highways and things like that, which is great. They're very, very powerful. But Hopper has more. He covers a bigger expanse: night paintings, day paintings, interior paintings, figures, no figures. So it's less formulaic.
Talk to me about nudes. I'm not complaining. I'm not complaining, but there are lots of naked women in your work.
Yes.
And why?
As I have, you know, various things that I, you know, some artists just repeat themselves pretty much over and over again and get away with it, and it's fine. You know, they might just do all paintings of the ocean. They might just do all paintings of, you know, some sort of abstract painting that looks similar over and over again. I get bored easily. So I have to have a range of topics that inspire me, right? So if I'm going to paint landscapes, I can't just go out to, you know, the outskirts of a city and just paint like a little average hill painting. I have to be blown away by the Flinders Ranges with afternoon light. It has to, you know, I have to boom, because it takes a lot of effort to work. So same with painting the figure. I was doing life drawings from art school, and I love it. And it's a great exercise, but I have to be inspired by what I paint. So I prefer to paint, you know, a beautiful woman that inspires me, and the shape and the you know, the personality is important. You know, the personality in the studio, the face, you know, the figure, all of that is so important. I just if as an art school student, you'll be presented with all sorts of models. There'll just be some old man, you know, there'll be, you know, a fat old lady and stuff like that, but I don't find, you know, a lot of that very inspiring. I love beauty. So I love to paint a beautiful woman.
I can't advise people more strongly to go out and check out your art. But one of the things, I mean, there's so many things, but one of the things you do that I think is astonishing is when I look at one of your paintings that has a nude in it, it isn't just a nude. There is a story that has been hinted at. So it is a beautiful nude in classical terms. So you know all the lines and the proportions and everything else are white and it's stunning and it's whatever. But there's like a story. A ankle will have a telephone wrapped around it, or there'll be an open fridge and a bloke with a syringe. Or you think, what? On second, you get two bites at the cherry. You think that's amazing. But hold on, who's that bloke on the bicycle through the window or whatever it is? So it's just very rewarding.
It's well. For me, I'm trying to give myself something to keep me going in the painting, a story that keeps me going, keeps me wondering. So I put, you know, if you put two different elements together, it brings the story somewhere else, and it usually doesn't complete it. So it's always just hanging. The story will be hanging, and I like that. So
now I have to ask, because I've got a few mates. I've got one who's a sculptor and a couple of friends who paint and do music. Is financially, is it a bittersweet symphony of domestic treachery and poverty, or does it pay like a bastard?
My first teacher always said, "Don't be an artist." And I used to think, "Oh, he's just joking. You know, he's sort of daring me to be an artist." But he was right. It was it's extremely difficult. Although it's taken me all over the world, and I've had residencies, you know, in Italy and in Greece,
Mexico and
you know, around America and things like that. But you know, when they run out, you're suddenly on your bum again, you know. So then you've got to restart up. You've got to somehow try and find buyers, clients, supporters, so it's a real big, you know, constant period of up and down, up and down. And very few artists in Australia just get past that level where they're comfortable all the time. That's a tiny percent. And I've not quite, you know, managed to crawl up to that height yet.
Yeah, so it never ends. But I suppose it sorts out those people who are authentically, passionately motivated, because you wouldn't bloody do it if you wanted an easy life.
No, but I've also learned that I can survive. And when things get hard, something comes through, it always comes through. It really does. And when I was about 33, I used to live in Sydney, and I used to be working in the cross area in a restaurant as a kitchen hand and things like that. And I remember I said, I'm sick of this. I'm not going to keep doing this the rest of my life. I'm not going to do anything but paint or teach. If I get hired at an institution, I'll teach. But that's it. And, I'll just die if I don't survive, So, and from that point on, that's what happened.
And the world then clicks into, I love the notion of intentional purpose.
Yeah.
When you actually, I gave up drink 20 years ago, but I spent lots of time trying to give up before.
Right.
But wanting the world to sort of organize itself to help me.
Yep.
And you go, nah. You decide exactly how you've just expressed.
Mm-hmm.
I am going to do X.
Yeah.
Come rain or shine. And then the world, surprisingly, does actually.
It's forced to sort of work around you.
So. I'm going to be an artist, whether you like it or not. And
that's right.
Okay, we like it.
Yeah.
Your fifth and final choice on Five and Life, it's always The Possession. And you have chosen record albums.
It's that was not an easy question because number one, I move so much in my life, and that I have very few possessions that, like if they all disappear, I've lived for years just on the road with everything in a storage container, so it's not that important. If they all disappear, it doesn't matter. But I, they give me great pleasure. Record albums, they're something I can afford. It's something that if I find the right op shop and there's a stack of records there, I know what I'm looking for. I know what I'm looking at. And it's one of those big relief and pleasurable things for me. But it gets harder and harder because so many people have gotten on to it. But, it's for years. I started recollecting records in about 2002, something like that. And now I would have several thousand, a thousand records. So.
And do you display them, or are they?
I've got racks. They look like a record store rack, So.
And are you an alphabetical nerd genre nerd, or just any type?
I like to put them in genres. So I particularly like collecting Australian records in the 60s, 70s, Australian, artists, rock artists,
And there's an amazing thing that I sound like a total boomer now, but it's a shame for my kids that they aren't going to be exposed to cover art.
Mm-hmm.
I remember being a little 12-year-old, and it would blow your mind standing in a record shop flipping through the LPs.
Yep.
Books, reading them.
Mm-hmm.
The concept albums, you'd open them and there might be like short stories inside. Just fantastic.
It was so exciting. I mean, so simple and so exciting as well. So.
Couple of questions for you to wrap up, and thank you again, mate, traveling to be here and share this with you. One, what's the kindest thing anyone has ever done for you?
Well, that's what a question that is. Oh, that is a really hard question. I'd have to think about it. I mean, people have done a lot of kind things for me. One of the kindest things was I got a residency in New Mexico back in 1987, and I applied for it for 10 years to get it, right? So when I finally got it, I sort of gelled so much with the guy that was actually the patron that he gave me two more residencies over the coming 20 years, completely supporting me, buying my paintings. And he was just such a lovely guy. His name is Donald Anderson, and he really gave me a huge boost in my life.
And is Donald still with us?
Donald died at 101 years old about a year and a half or 2 years ago.
I love hearing people say nice things about other people behind their backs. So that's a lovely story. The last question is the traditional one, which is, who would you like to hear on Five My Life next, and why?
I'd love to hear Michael Gray Griffith on Five of My Life. Michael is absolutely a passionate person about getting Australian stories. He has been going around Australia for almost 2 years getting stories from marginalised people who have been marginalised by what's happened to Australia in the past couple of years. And his stories are absolutely mind-blowing. And he's passionate about it, and somehow he's been supported. But initially, there was no way that he saw any support. And Michael Gray Griffith.
Does he write books? Or
he was a playwright before he couldn't be a playwright anymore. And then he just wanted to get other people's stories. And he's one of the best people to draw stories out of people that I have been around, apart from yourself. He really facilitates people talking, doesn't get in their way, and just draws out some, you know, really very strong stories out of them. So,
well, I'll give him a ring. Michael Gray Griffiths. Stewart MacFarlane, thank you so much for sharing your Five on Five My Life.
Oh, look, I'm just blown away that you invited me, that you found me, and that you enjoy my work so much. That really lifts me up incredibly. And thank you, Nigel.
Oh, pleasure. Thank you for listening to this episode. If you follow Five of My Life, you might enjoy my latest book, Smart, Stupid and 60. In it, I write about a number of the issues discussed on the show. It's the 20-year follow-on from my first book, Fat, 40 and Fired. If you have any feedback on the book or suggestions for the show, please get in touch via my website, nigelmarsh.com.